Who is this irresistible creature who has an insatiable love for the dead?
It's Halloween. The season of spook has reached its climax and the whole world smells like a Kit Kat. Originally, I wanted to make this a 5 PS2 horror games video. That video is still in the works, but I think I need to put it on the back burner because I need one more game to complete the set. So instead of missing the holiday because of dedication to something that nobody cares about, I figured I'd just put it to the side and do this instead. Today we're gonna look at Rock of the Dead. I know, I said no more rhythm games, but trust me when I say that calling this a rhythm game is like smacking a soup pot and calling it a drum. It might make a noise, but that doesn't make it an instrument. Rock of the Dead, developed by Epicenter Games and published by UFO Interactive in 2010, is an on-rail shooter that you play with a guitar controller. I bet you're probably asking yourself, how the fuck does that work? But you'll have to wait a few minutes to find out, because first, some backstory. The original IGN article talking about Rock of the Dead before release gives us a couple of interesting hints about the history. Originally, Rock of the Dead was supposed to be a Wii exclusive. In a weird and unclarified twist of fate, the exact opposite thing happened. Rock of the Dead released for PlayStation 3, Xbox 360, and iOS, and totally skipped the Wii. We do know for a fact that a playable Wii prototype exists out in the wild somewhere. It's the port that the original article talks about. So technically, the original Rock of the Dead is lost media. Outside of that, there isn't much information out there. Any of the devs for this game that see this, maybe, I have a couple of questions. What actually sparked the development of this game? Was it ever supposed to be something different? Whatever happened to the Wii port? Honestly, I'd love to shoot this shit and do a full interview, but like, I think for the sake of preserving video game history, we just need more information on this one generally. Anything would be helpful. Before I talk about the gameplay, let's talk about the actors and the writing. Apparently, the script for this game was written by one of the scriptwriters for The Witcher. Witcher 2 wasn't out by that point, so it had to be a member from the first game. Or maybe the author of the books. I don't know. I have no idea. The bulk of the writing is one-liners and dry jokes that are honestly kind of charming. If you're expecting S-tier writing, remember, this is a budget game where you kill zombies and monsters with a guitar controller. It's not Elden Ring, so it doesn't really need to have the best writing ever. This is an instance where the writing gets better as it gets worse. I can't give the writing all of the credit, though. The majority of the charm comes from the delivery of Neil Patrick Harris.
Stay back, or taste, me. You're endangered now, buddy. Subway station, check. Zombie invasion, check. Right on, back on track.
Honestly, he didn't have to put so much energy into it, but I appreciate that he did. Neelio plays the role of our main character, and he does a great job becoming the vocal embodiment of the surfer, skater, rocker stereotype. Not many of the jokes land, in fact, only a few of them do. But it's the jokes that crash and burn hard that really are the best. Some of them have no business being as funny as they are. Let's finally talk about that gameplay. I've already mentioned that this is an on-rail shooter so that you play with a guitar controller a couple of times. Like I said before, calling it a rhythm game is pretty generous. Most of the gameplay amounts to playing patterns that pop up in front of enemies on the screen. They don't really fit in time with the music, so it's not really rhythm per se. The bulk of them are single measure patterns, with the occasional 5/4 time measure thrown in to give it more challenge. I already said that you don't have to play the notes in time with the music. Actually, preferably, you should be playing them as fast as you can. Since most of them don't line up with the music anyway, you have to put in the extra visual effort. Occasionally, an enemy will stop you and bring up a scrolling highway. In moments like this, it actually is a rhythm game. The highway is standard, notes pass the strike line, and you play them. Interestingly, this game actually has hammer-ons and long notes. The phrases for these moments are short enough to feel like a stronger enemy, but not so long that enemies feel like bullet sponges, and it's very responsive. I can't even believe that I'm saying this about a guitar game, but it's a genuine concern. I think any one phrase taking too long to complete would interfere with the rest of the game. They're perfectly sized to be comfortable. That applies specifically to this game. I don't know how it looks to you as the viewer, but if it looks like I'm easily plowing through this game, I really wasn't. It's pretty difficult, even if you're a seasoned guitar game player. The orientation of the notes is initially very confusing. Learning to play Ghidorah came with the stipulation of reorienting myself as well, but it wasn't nearly as heavy as this. Staring at sideways highways like this is like staring at Lefty Flip. My brain just shuts down and doesn't really know what to do. When you're playing the hardest difficulty, there are a ton of moments where you really only have a few seconds to react. In moments like those, trying to play the patterns first is the wrong move. There are two power-ups available at our disposal to get through some heavier things. First is the shield, which is exactly what it sounds like. It's a temporary shield that'll give you a health bar protection long enough to play a few patterns. The second is the blast, which can be used to clear off multiple enemies simultaneously. I'll go ahead and tell you the exact best times to use each of them. The shield should be used anytime a swarm of monsters is coming at you too fast. It'll give you enough time to clear off some of the patterns without taking any damage. The blast should be used specifically for rescues. There are a ton of moments throughout the game where you'll have to take out a wave of enemies to rescue civilians. Usually, there are too many enemies to play the patterns before civvies die, so we use the blast to clear them out instead. There aren't any other times where you need it. If you aren't doing a rescue, then you should be using the shield. Both of those power-ups are upgradable to be more effective. Completing levels will grant you points to allocate whichever power-up you want to upgrade. Generally speaking, it doesn't matter which order you upgrade them in, but you'll be using the shield more often, and you'll need bigger blasts for rescues, so I found that the best course of action was to just upgrade them as evenly as possible. The game's difficulty paces itself along with the upgrades that you need, which is a really great depth of design that I wasn't expecting to find in such a weird place. If you happen to die at any point in the game, don't worry about it too much. It hurts your score, but you'll be able to continue from right where you left off, so if you want to beat the game, you won't ever run into any stuck moments. This really doesn't hurt the difficulty as much as it sounds like. The aim of this game isn't to get from point A to point B. The aim is to get the highest score possible on each level. I couldn't nail down exactly how it works, but I think dying lowers your score multiplier. If you die too many times in a row, you may only be getting a few points at a time, so it actually does contribute to the difficulty of getting big scores. The music in this game is great. There are a couple of original tracks, but the majority of it is Rob Zombie music, and I can't think of anything more fitting. They got some really good ones too, like American Witch, Super Beast, and Dragula. I know it isn't for everybody. Rob Zombie music is a specific kind of taste, but that specific taste works well with this game because the game itself is a product of that same taste. That ultimately is the biggest drawback to Rock of the Dead. It isn't a game made for everybody. There's an extremely specific audience of people who would enjoy it. To those of us who do, it's a cult classic. None of those bullshit cult classics where it's really something that everybody likes that just gets called that because it isn't a part of a franchise. I mean a real cult classic, where a select few who remember it fondly can go back to it nostalgically. For those of you who are interested, RPCS3 has a network function called RPCN that acts sort of like an emulated PlayStation network. Rock of the Dead is compatible with RPCN, and the leaderboard is in perfect working order. It's pretty empty right now, just me and one other person, but the leaderboards work if you want to share your scores across with other RPCN users. I think I covered everything, so we'll go ahead and give it a rating. This might not make sense to some people, but I think Rock of the Dead is deserving of a solid 7 out of 10. It's not a masterpiece, more like a B-movie. It's got a lot of charm, it's really cheesy, it's pretty low budget, and it's a lot of fun. It's not really something for everybody, it's so audience-specific that it borders on inaccessible. You need to be a really certain kind of person to enjoy it, and that holds it back, but it's good, and I recommend it to you if it looks like something you're interested in. Or, if you're a fan of guitar games and you've never played it, I'd also recommend giving it a look then. Even if you don't like it, you'll be able to say that you killed zombies with your guitar controller, so at least that's something. Happy Halloween, thank you, and have a nice day.